Hello everybody, I'm Raphaël Lapote from the National Library of France. I've come to tell you about cool URIs at the BNF and how we try to handle persistent identifiers those days, which is kind of complex. I will be speaking about three matters. I will start with general consideration about cool URIs and how we implemented it at the BNF, and how we implemented it in the data.bnf.fr project. By the way, I'm the administrator and product owner for the data.bnf.fr project. This is a reason why I will speak about cool URIs in data.bnf.fr mostly. Then I will try to explain to you the mutability problems that we encounter at the BNF those days. Last year we had a talking session about HTTPS and the problems that it would raise for persistency of the URIs. And so this will be a good part of my talk. And lastly, I will tell you about what solution we are considering for ensuring a more persistent access and identification to our resources at the BNF and in data.bnf.fr. So, cool URIs. Well, that's a vast matter. According to the W3C, well, I'm not an expert and I didn't read so much the note, but what I did see in this note is the three statements: be on the web, be unambiguous, and cool URIs aren't supposed to change. So, yes, the URI should provide access to HTML and RDF description and use HTTP protocol. So you have to provide referencing to the object on the web. And you are supposed to be unambiguous, meaning by that one identifier is supposed to identify really one object, mostly. Cool URIs are not supposed to change. Persistency is supposed to somehow be linked to the fact that the URIs will stay the same. So basically it will keep on identifying one object, which is the same, and its syntax and its design is not supposed to change too. So it has to remain the same as long as possible. And so persistency here rely a lot on this not changing of the URIs. So how we did implement it, it at the National Library of France? Well, we decided at the BNF to build some kind of articulation between access to the resource and identification of the resource. So every URI persistent identifier at the BNF is built on RRK recommendation. We're using an ARC name, which is here you can see the BBT 6K10 7371T, which is the identification of the object. And what can change in that URI is the access domain name, meaning that this ARC can be read through a lot of different applications in the BNF. It can be read by Gallica BNF.fr, but it can also be read by the catalog, the main catalog of the BNF. So it would be catalog.bnf.fr/arc. And it can also be interpreted by the data.bnf.fr linked data portal. And so we really make a difference between access to the resource and identification of the resource. Also, we use what we call qualificatives, which are kind of fragments. So you can use the same arc with different fragments to identify different parts of the resource. Identified here, the F134 identify a view of one page in a digitized document, Gallica being our digital library. So here's another schema to illustrate this. I like to present Arc as a key, and there are several parts in a key. And you can have a cover. The cover is a domain name, which interprets and give a different version of the identified object. So this cover can be Gallica, can be Catalogue General, so catalogue.bnf.fr, but it could be data.bnf.fr, and it could be Archives and Manuscripts Catalogue at the BNF. We also use what we call a shoulder. So this shoulder actually is the beginning of the identifier. Here, the identifier is BPT6K107371. So the identifier is starting by BPT, and BPT is indicating a Gallica resource. While CB is identifying a more catalog resource, and CC is a shoulder for BNF archives and manuscripts. The tip is a fragment that I show you, the F134 in this URI. So this is how we built cool URIs. We tried to implement the W3C node, but we try to articulate differently access and identification of the resource. What we did in databnf.fr was to do another differentiation between access and identification. Actually, so this portal, linked open data portal, is also web referencing project. So it has an HTML interface, which is supposed to speak to search engines with understandable, human readable URL for the web. Which can also allow for content negotiation to gate RDF data. It's differentiated from permanent identification. So if I click on this first URI, here that you can see over there, it is also going, if you click on it, you will see an HTML page. But it's also the persistent identifier, and it can identify both the concept of the real thing in the world and the real thing, the real entity in the world, with the JS about at the end of the URI. So we use fragmentation, and we make another differentiation between access, web referencing, and identification in this open data project. So, till now, it has worked quite well. We could ensure persistency to our URIs. But lastly, we encountered a lot of mutability problems, and I will explain why. Well, first, there is this problem of HTTP and going to HTTPS. So here you have a good illustration of my face when I discovered that our triple store, a good percentage of our URIs had gone to HTTPS without me knowing about it. So no, I wasn't happy. And the right face is the face of our users when they have been trying to use our Sparkle endpoints, because some of the URIs were in HTTPS and some other were in HTTP, and there was no logic in that. So they couldn't really understand how to use the Sparkle. Sparkle endpoint being quite complicated anyway, so it wouldn't help a lot. Other problem is that we've been lately reforming our RAMO syntax. So RAMO is our vocabulary at the BNF, and we try to adapt it to a more linked open data approach with a fragmentation in entities rather than a strict syntax for cataloging. So that means that lots of resources has been or will be deleted, resources will be replaced, and resources can be split or merged. I'm sorry, it's not really readable. It's a format problem. For instance, we had this indexing term, which is women in mythology, and it will be split into different terms, women for one side and mythology for the in the other side. So it will become two resources instead of one. So URIs has to be either changed or split, or we have to find a solution. So lots of moving resources at the BNF. And lastly, we encounter another problem of immutability in the URI, specifically in the data.bnf.fr projects, since we've been experimenting a project of calculation of work entities. I've been speaking about that last year. And so we've been producing works that are only existing in the data.bnf.fr interface. But those works are temporary, meaning by that they are just for a few months in the interface, so that we can have feedback from users and integrate it in the catalog. And then they are reintegrated in the catalog. So those URIs are built with a temp work mention in it, so that we can so that we can explain to the user that it's a temporary URI, that it shouldn't be used for citation. But it is also using a hash identifier, which is built from the different manifestations that were used to calculate the work. And if we recalculate the work, different manifestation can be used, so different identification. So we have to change the hash. So there's a mutability both of the work entity, since different manifestations are under this work entity, and it can be recalculated, and manifestations are changing. And the URI is changing too, since the hash is calculated from the manifestations. So, well, persistent URI is kind of a dream for us now. So we've been having some reflection about how to keep ensuring persistent access and identification to our resources. And to make this presentation, I've been speaking mostly to Bertrand Garon, who is the person responsible for digital preservation at the BNF, and had a very interesting consideration about persistent access. Well, our conclusion, I will come to it, but our conclusion is that stability of the design of the URL is not in itself a guarantee of of persistency of the access to the resource. It's just a good sign of it. What is really a guarantee of persistency is the fact that the object identified is being preserved, and the URI is being preserved, meaning by that there is a digital preservation policy implemented world at the top level of the institution, so that we keep track of changing the URIs. So one of the first recommendations that we have about persistency would be to have talking identifiers. For instance, we use an inflection on our RRK's URIs, which is a dot policy inflection. So when you interrogate the URIs and you add dot policy to the URI, you are given access to this text, French text. We should translate it. It's not translated yet, but we'll do it. It explains you what we are doing to ensuring persistency at the BNF. So there's general consideration about the ARC, how we use it at the BNF, how resources can be changed at the BNF, different ways of changing it, and how we use address authorities, and we try to make services available most of the times, but sometimes it doesn't work. Another key for persistency is good practices in digital preservation. Meaning by that, when you manage records in the catalogs, you need to make ghosts or tombstone when a resource is deleted or merged or split. And you have to, the catalogers supposed to keep a track of the change in the identifiers and change in the resources and indicate it in the records itself, so that it can be used by different applications to ensure redirection to the good resource whenever it's possible. It's also true for digitalized resources, which are kept in the SPAR store, which is our digital preservation tool at the BNF for the digitalized resources. And lastly, question was at the BNF if we would build a big central knowledge base of everything changing in our resources. It's kind of a utopian project. But what we know is that we need to have a top level to keep tracks of every change in different applications and different kind of use of the resources and records and identifiers at the BNF. And so that means having some way, a file somewhere where everything is kept and recorded and every change. This could, this could be also used to implement a prov ontology, maybe. That's, I had that that reflection. Lastly, so yes, I don't have a good answer for this persistency problem, but really having a digital preservation expert at the BNF is helping a lot. Thank you very much.
Question.
Hi, thank you. I was wondering, how is your approach related to DOIs? Do you also give your items in DOI as well, or?
I'm not sure I understood the question.
The DOIs, digital object identifier, are also another way to give a persistent URL to items. So maybe this there is some connection to your approach. So this was the idea.
The fact that we are giving URIs to digitalized resources, so in Gallica, for instance, is it helping? That's your question. Actually, our digital preservation policy is completely tied to our Gallica digital library, because we need to ensure digital preservation for a lot of web resources and a lot of digitalized resources, and it's truly a central matter for the BNF. So this is the reason why we have a big store for keeping track of everything related to Gallica and the rest. And yes, it has a lot of influence on our perception of persistency of URIs, absolutely.
Another one?
Yeah. I think they all want coffee. So, yeah, thank you again. And before you all rush.